Yo, what is up? Welcome to Ninja Geek Games. Do you feel the need to call out the Neolithic period, expand across the land, improve tech and the morale of your tribes, and perhaps make a few allies? Era of Tribes is a civilization worker placement game where you can do just that. In this game, you get to select one of 10 tribes and use your leaders to deploy vassals, build fleets and cities, attack barbarians and other players, as well as taxing your people and initiating a revolution, all with some form of benefit and potential negative consequence. The aim of the game is to expand your tribe and progress your mighty empire in such a way that you fulfill one of the 6 endgame conditions that include reaching or controlling a specific number of victory points, land provinces or improvements, increasing a victory marker from battles to owning another player's home provinces and progressing to a particular area in time. If one of these conditions are reached, then victory points are scored. Now, I'm not going to discuss the rules of the game in depth, as this is a very heavy game. Plus, there is an excellent Rado run-through learn-to-play video from Knights Around a Table, and I'll put a link to that in this description. In this video, I'll provide a review of the game with my thoughts on the various aspects. First, we'll take a look at the components and setup. The first thing you'll notice is this huge and wonderfully illustrated board representing a world map of ancient times. The map is split into land and sea provinces, with icons for various luxury goods that you'll get if you control that province. Each of the tribes have their home provinces, so you'll get the Brits, Norse, Romans, Greek for example. These larger hex-shaped areas have no gameplay value, but are used to mark off unusable areas dependent on player count or game. The board does appear busy at first glance, but during setup you'll place tokens on all these icons so you know which ones have been claimed during the game. This is your influence point track that essentially represents your victory points, and here indicates the various ways that influence can be scored throughout the game. Starting here and move backwards is the victory parade track that increases or decreases based on battle outcome. This is the morale track, and there are various actions that decrease your morale, such as waging war or taxing your people, whereas making allies or entertaining your tribes increases your morale, and those actions are listed here. This giant X represents the improvement track that provides your tribe with bonuses, increased trade values or army and fleet movement, as well as unlocking specific actions that can only be taken if you reach specific levels of the track. There are 6 areas of the track that you can advance on, and briefly, mechanics allows you to increase land vassal movement, architecture allows you to build cities, whereas agriculture gives you food and the ability to host additional vassals in your provinces. Culture gives you victory points, as well as bonuses to additional actions to increase morale. Navigation allows you to buy fleets and increase their movement. Lastly, commerce increases your trade value actions, as well as giving you the ability to build trading posts with other players. This is the era track that allows you to perform a revolution action if you have the required goods, cities and improvements, and also provides you with additional bonuses for advancement. This area represents turn order, which is decided based on the reverse order of the victory point track. And here is the barbarian chart that dictates how tough the barbarians are in battle. This area hosts 2 face-up influence cards that are scored during a revolution. There are 10 player boards to choose from, each representing a unique tribe, and they vary slightly for asymmetric play. Each player board has many areas where vassals that are waiting to join your army or the map are placed here. And this area holds your cities and additional vassals that are locked at the beginning of the game. Any food you gain in the game is placed here. And these areas indicate the 7 actions that you can take in the game by placing your leaders. Now, as you can tell, the components of the game are really good quality. The board is incredible and has huge table presence, and not just because of its size. Player boards, cards and tokens are of thick cardstock, and the goods tokens are painted wood with detailed illustration of the item and a coloured background to indicate whether it's a luxury or military good. However, some of the areas on the board, especially the improvement track and player boards, are busy. There is a load of iconography that sometimes doesn't seem to fully represent the action or bonus you're carrying out, but as you learn the rules and play the game, this issue subsides a little. The setup is pretty straightforward, but it's very time consuming. I felt myself progressing to the next era in life just for completing a setup. You have to match like 50 goods tokens to the map areas, place barbarians tokens, and then set up your player board, where you again have over 50 player pieces each that need to be neatly lined up. Other than that, once set up, the game looks so inviting, but you do need a lot of table space to play this. So the gameplay. The game has a number of phases per round where you first check for morale, determine play order, take your actions and clean up. Now one thing to note is that the game has many moving parts. Actions taken have consequences in your morale and influence points. Some parts of actions can only be played if you've reached the required area on the improvement tracks, and to improve you need to spend money. But gaining money from your people decreases morale that can also cause you to lose influence points. During play, there are up to 7 actions you can take, and these actions can be buffed up by playing multiple leaders to the same action, as well as adding luxury goods collected from the map. Already you can see that expanding your empire is an important part of the game, and it can be a long and complex step, but some of the actions are very simple. Play a leader, go up a track. Let's take a look. So I'll briefly go over the actions so you can get an idea of gameplay and how the actions relate to each other. Firstly, money is an important commodity. It allows you to buy improvements, other players' land, as well as fleets, to name a few. The trade action allows you to get a little bit of money with no real consequences. Whereas taxing your people allows you to gain a lot more and also increases with the number of cities that you've placed on the map. However, the more money you gain from taxes goes hand in hand with morale decrease, so make sure you're prepped to take this loss. If you take the improvement action, you can move up the improvement track and immediately gain the benefit. There are 6 tracks and cost is dependent on your position in relation to other players on that track, as well as the position of your markers on neighbouring tracks. Now some game actions are locked until you reach their improvement on the track. So during the game, you cannot build cities to place on the map unless you reach this level on the architecture track. Likewise, vassals can only be placed in the water as fleets if you've reached this level or higher on the navigation track. And being the first player to reach a new level on the track gains you 1 influence point. For diplomacy, there are 3 sub-actions that you can take that allow you to gain an additional leader, of which there are a limited number, prevent players from attacking you that turn, as well as changing the turn order of the next round. And again, most of these actions cost money. This action also includes a bonus action that allows you to ally with other players or buy their land, and either can be done as an agreement or forcefully. If you place one of your leaders on the bread and circus action, it allows you to increase your morale, as you're able to entertain your people. If you play the revolution action, it means you can move into the next era, where you must demonstrate you have the required prerequisites to do so, and this can gain you influence, leaders, as well as goods and morale. The last action is expand, which is possibly the most complex as it has multiple stages. This allows you to gain a number of free vassals based on your morale standing and your food. Therefore, if you can feed and motivate your army, they'll fight for you. These vassals can be placed onto the map, and they can move into other provinces to collect food and luxury goods. If you can pay, as well as having unlocked the fleet area on the improvement track, you can place any newly placed vassals on the map into fleets that can then explore the sea. And this lets you set out and conquer distant lands. You can also use your vassals to build trade posts with other players. That gives you additional money during trade actions, as well as build cities, but this does cost food. During this action, you can also move into other players' provinces on land or at sea to start battle. Battle uses this special board to place tokens and armies and military items gained from the map. Those military items include luxury goods that include ore, as well as pretty ponies. Players then gain these tokens dependent on who's winning strength, advanced highest on the mechanic track, as well as who has the highest morale. Each player then rolls their own die, but players can then lose part of their army. Win, and you get to move your victory parade around the track, but you will lose morale. You can also decide to fight barbarians, and if you win, you can place them in your army to use later, or you can flip them to claim the bonus on the reverse side. So this was just a brief overview of the actions, but there are some other components that you need to consider. Although each action can only be taken once per round, you can add additional leaders onto those actions to get better benefits. Therefore, do you place 3 separate leaders to carry out more actions, or instead place 2 or more leaders to get a bigger benefit from only 1 action? Not only that, any luxury goods you have can be placed on an action space for similar effect. Note that these luxury goods are yours for the remainder of the game whilst you own that land province that they came from. Vacate that area by moving or loss in battle and you have to replace it. Now, being allies has benefits too. It gets you morale plus the ability to move through provinces owned by that player without battle, but you can break this alliance. Also, whilst in battle, your ally can sell you their units to use, and if you win, they get a share of the spoils of war. To remember who you are allied with, each player will swap leader meeples as a token of friendship. Ah, the way the improvement track works with regards to cost appears complex at first, but after careful study, you get the idea. The reason for various costs dependent on position is so that players don't run away with the leader of the tracks, taking all the influence points, which makes the game more balanced. Choosing which track to ascend can cause a bit of analysis paralysis, as they are so varied, so you really need to think a few steps ahead to see where that benefit lies. Now, deciding on whether to move land vassals, place fleets, or build cities as part of your expansion is a strategic part of the game, and you need to seriously consider the benefits over expanding and possible future income. One last thing that also needs to be seriously considered is whether you take this expansion action at all. This is because when the action phase finishes, everyone who did not take the expansion action is now forced to do so, but you do not get the leader benefit. Therefore, if you want to take this action, but it's not a priority, you know you're going to take it at the end of the round for free with a smaller vassal placement. However, you may not want to take an expansion action at all due to low morale and little food, meaning that you're forced to take it at the end of the round and could end up with a penalty for starving your army. So you'll need to alter your strategy to prevent this. The rulebook. I think the rulebook lets the game down. This is a heavy, complex game that needs a well-written rulebook. It's 30 pages long and at times not wholly clear. Although it's well laid out with clear headings and is color-coded to match the player action boards, it does make learning a complex game all the more harder. Some of the images and text don't appear to correlate well, and it requires multiple reads to get the basics. However, as mentioned, you should definitely check out the Learn to Play video from Knights Around a Table, as that fully explains all the rules in detail. Ultimately, this game is epic. Once the rules are learned, you are in for a highly strategic and very rewarding game. The component quality is excellent, the board is incredible, and the engine building is solid. The unique combat mechanics work really well and are quite fast-paced, which is sorely needed in this game. The use of allies in battle, as well as through other actions, is really fun and a must in order to fulfill your potential. All actions at some point link to future actions. That is a mechanic I really like and promotes forward thinking. That includes requirements for supply versus expansion when vacating areas that provide goods or increasing morale before battle to claim those advantageous battle tokens. This, however, can cause analysis paralysis, but can be negated by planning your action in another player's turn, as there can be quite some downtime. One thing I haven't discussed is the influence cards that support applying and changing tactics during the game. Each player gets a secret influence card during setup that are used for scoring endgame influence. This includes things like owning the most land, money, or specific good provinces. Also, when an era is moved into for the first time, that player gets to choose which of the two face-up influence cards are scored. This may benefit them directly, or played so that if they can't gain the influence, they will have some say on who will. The game ends when one of the six victory conditions are met, but dependent on the game played, there are variants where the game stops only when a certain number of endgame conditions are achieved by a player. This makes the game considerably longer and more challenging, but becomes epic in every sense of the word, and I really enjoy this variant. The downside is that it's very difficult to determine who has which victory condition at any one time, and regularly results in stopping play to carry out a check. A sideboard with player tokens to mark score conditions will be beneficial here. You can also expand the game with two additional players for a mammoth six-player game, as well as adding modular board for a fog of war mechanic. Again, a very rewarding experience where I still suggest reducing the map size for more battles. As the map can be constructed in various ways, plus the asymmetric abilities of the tribes, the game has exceptionally high replay value. The Britons get more food from fishing, the Romans get additional military power, and my favourite, the Norse, get to pillage other players from sea and can also send their vassals to Valhalla. Skull! Some of the abilities appear at first glance better than others, but you really need to play your tribe strengths. The game seems balanced, but I do recommend checking which tribes will be used based on map player, as you could start the game with some of the tribes boxed in. In summary, this is one of my favourite new games played this year, and I'm really looking forward to playing it again. Yes, it appears complex, and the rulebook doesn't fully support this properly, but its complexity is outshined by tactical play and strategic management of supplies and tracks. Thanks for watching. This is Ninja Geek Games. Cheers.